everybody. This is Elizabeth Potts Weinstein. And today we are talking about the top five mistakes that people make when they're trying to file their own trademark application. My laptop here is checking to make sure that everything's running okay. For when you're filing your own trademark application, you have the option to just do it yourself. You don't have to hire an attorney or a trademark attorney specifically to represent you before the United States Patent and Trademark Office, unless you are not a resident of the United States. That's one exception. You'll need to have somebody here in the US who is representing you. But if you're here in the United States, you can represent yourself. So how does that work if you are not an experienced trademark attorney? It's possible to get a trademark even if you don't have a lawyer, but there are a lot of mistakes that even lawyers who aren't experienced trademark attorneys can make, as well as civilians who are not attorneys. So let's go through those five different mistakes that tend to be the most common. So hopefully that won't happen to you if you decide to file your own trademark application. So the first one is not doing a search before you apply for the trademark. Now, for those of you who don't know that much about trademark law, a trademark is some word or phrase or symbol that you use in conjunction with the sale of a product or service. And in a lot of ways, it's a first dibs kind of situation. Whoever gets the first trademark has dibs over that phrase in regard to that product or service category. So you need to check if anybody else already has dibs over that phrase or that logo or whatever it is that you're trying to trademark. Now, many people do some kind of search, and hopefully you're doing some kind of search. You want to do it early. You want to do it before you start making your branding, before you get a domain name, like all that stuff. You want to do the search as soon as possible so you don't waste your time, okay? But you also obviously want to do a good search before you file a trademark application, because the trademark office is going to examine your application. And if someone else has dibs, you're not going to get it. And you've wasted all that time and energy and money. Now, the search you need to do, you want to search both on the trademark office's database, which is a free thing to search. You can go to uspto.gov and you can find the trademark database to do a search in. But you also want to search in other places. You want to at least search on Google. You may want to look on Amazon. You may want to look in domain names, a lot of different things. Just because you can get the domain name for that phrase doesn't mean somebody else doesn't have something similar enough that the trademark office is going to reject you. So you don't want to waste your time there. Even if you're not going to file a trademark application, you should actually be doing these searches anyway, because you don't want someone else to already have the trademark and then come after you once you've created a beautiful website. Now, the other issue with the searches is you can't search just the literal phrase that you're going to trademark. So let me give you an example. Let's say I wanted to trademark the name of my law firm, which is EPW Small Business Law. I can't just do searches on EPW Small Business Law. I know that's not going to come up with anything else, but I have to also do searches that are more broad. So what do I mean by that? Well, part of that theoretical trademark is small business law, which is kind of a generic term for what I do. Those aren't the special words in the trademark. The special part of the trademark is the EPW. So what I would do is a search for EPW in categories that are similar to mine. So I do legal services, so I'd look for any other EPW trademarks in the legal services category. And it might be EPW commercial law, for example. Well, that's really close. Commercial law, small business law, it's not the exact same, but it's very similar in the categories of things that I would be providing and these other guys would be providing. And so someone could be confused by them that we're the same law firm. And the trademark office isn't going to let that through. And you want to know that about that way, way ahead of time. Also, things like having a dash in the middle or a space or not a space or spelling it in a creative way, all that kind of stuff. You need to look for those too. Just because you change it a tiny bit doesn't mean that you're going to get yours through if someone else already has dibs. So that's the first one, is doing a really good search. In the mistake is people who don't do a good search. The second mistake is using your trademark phrase in a merely descriptive way on your website, which that sounds very legalese probably, because what does that even mean? So let's say I was going to trademark legal serendipity, just that phrase, legal serendipity, and that was going to be the name of my new law firm or something. Well, that might get through, maybe. But here's going to be the issue. The trademark office is going to say, well, legal serendipity sounds all kind of clever, but it's kind of just a description for what you do for people. You create their legal serendipity. I don't actually know if that makes any sense, but let's just take that as a hypothetical. So the trademark office might say, well, that's just a generic or merely descriptive term for the results you get for clients. And we're not going to let you have dibs over that. Here's the mistake that people make where they sabotage themselves. So let's say on my website, I talk about how if so, you sign up for my services, I will create legal serendipity for you. I'm actually using the term in a merely descriptive way for the results that people get. I've kind of made my term generic. And if you make your own term generic on your own website, the trademark office is totally going to find that because they always look on your website. And you've just totally defeated yourself in your trademark application. This happens over and over again. Because a lot of times, what makes a good trademark is also what makes good marketing, good keywords. And when I say it makes a good trademark, it makes a good trademark in the eyes, in the ears of your customers or clients. But it doesn't get through the trademark office because they object to it as being merely descriptive. Sometimes you actually have to decide if you're going to get a trademark or if you're going to have really good keywords and a really good domain name and really good marketing. It can be the opposite in a lot of ways. So if you're considering trademarking something that is a kind of a description of what you do, a description of your system, a description of the results your clients or customers get, a description of what they are going to get for their own customers or clients, you really have to think about how you're using it in your own branding, on your own website, how you're using it in your own marketing, how you're pitching it to people when you're doing podcasts, all that, because all that can come back and be used against you in your trademark application. So that's number two, checking over your own website to see if you use it, your trademark, in a merely descriptive way. Number three comes up with intent to use applications. So an intent to use application is, let's say you're thinking about changing your branding, you're coming up with a new product or service. So you've come up with this idea for a trademark, but you haven't actually started using it yet. And you decide to file a trademark application on it now before you use it. That's called an intent to use application because you intend to use it in the future. And that can be a great idea to get dibs on something so no one else gets it. But here's the problem, is that if you haven't really decided on your branding, you haven't worked out all the details, sometimes what happens is you will file a intent to use application on a brand, on EPW Small Business Law, and then decide later to change something out of it. Maybe I decide I'm not going to just do small businesses. I'm going to do all businesses. So I start using EPW Business Law in when I actually launch that business. Well, then my trademark application is moot. It's not helpful to me anymore because I filed a trademark application on EPW Small Business Law, not EPW Business Law. Also, if you do even little tweaks, it can be a big problem. If you take out the spaces or put in spaces in between your words, if you use dashes, if you file a trademark over a logo and you decide to change the colors in it or something, you change the way the fonts work, whatever it is. Those changes means like when you get a trademark, you're getting it over that exact thing. And if you make changes in your branding before you launch, you're not going to be able to get your trademark because you can't give them proof. You can't get them a proof of your use of that exact trademark that you originally filed. So that's mistake number three, is not having your branding be really decided before you file an intent to use application. Number four, which can be related to the intent to use, is you file your trademark application in the wrong class. So what's a class? A class is a category of product or services. So if I was going to file a trademark for UBW Small Business Law, it would be in the category that's about legal services. But I could also file a trademark application for UBW Small Business Law in, let's say, education and information. That's a category about teaching stuff. I could, you know, doing classes like this, doing seminars, live events, whatever it is. And I could file that trademark application in probably multiple categories, depending upon the exact services I'm providing or the exact products. There's a number of products and services that can go in many, many categories. And which one to put them in depends upon exactly what you're going to be doing in now and in the future. What of all the things you're doing, what's the most important to get dibs on? And it depends upon what else is out there. So let's say there's another EPW in legal services. So I might be like, well, I'm not even going to worry about the legal services one. I'm going to focus on the parts of my business where I do teaching. And so I'm going to get a trademark in the information education category and focus there. That may or may not be a good idea, but it's very important to be intentional. You can go in many categories for almost any trademark application, and you want to pick one on purpose, strategically. Also, with those intent to use applications, if you aren't already using your trademark in selling products or services, and you have an idea of how you're going to use it, you may end up doing something different when you actually launch your business in 6 months or 2.5 years or whenever it is. So you need to, when you pick that class for that intent to use application, you need to kind of know what you're going to be selling and what at least the first thing you're going to be selling. I've had many times where people and even some of my clients where we've picked a class for their intent to use application, and then 2.5 years later, when they actually launch, they're not doing that same thing anymore. You know, no one can see the future, so a lot of ways you're making a guess, but you do want to be artful of the class, the category that you put your trademark application in. So that's number four. Number five is just missing a deadline. So when you file a trademark application, you are going to be have that application be examined by an examiner. And there's all these deadlines that you have to meet in response to whatever they send to you. So for example, maybe they send you an office action because they find something wrong about your trademark that needs to be tweaked. Maybe it's something you just need to reword something in that class description. That's a common issue. Well, you have 6 months to reply to it. Now, hopefully you're going to be able to reply to it the first few weeks, but maybe not. Maybe you haven't decided what to do. You're thinking about maybe hiring an attorney. Who knows? It's very easy for that 6 months to go by and for you to miss that deadline because it's so long. So you have to make sure that you put in all your deadlines in your calendar. The same thing with intent to use applications. Once your trademark application is granted, you have... Sorry, Adobe Flash Player just popped up. Once your trademark application has been granted, you still have to file proof of your use before you actually get the trademark, if it's an intent to use application. And then you get 6 months. You can do extensions and pay them more money to get more and more extensions up to 3 years. But you might forget about it because you did this trademark application, it got granted, you're really happy about it, and then you're in this waiting period before you launch. You don't want to miss one of those deadlines. Number one, if you miss them, sometimes you can get it back, but you got to pay them a whole lot more money to get it back, to petition to get it back. And so if you are too late, your trademark is gone and you've wasted all that time and money. So you want to make sure that not only are you putting all the dates in your calendar or some tickler system, but you also check the status of your trademark application regularly. I have another video on that, which I can post below, but after this is over. But you want to go in probably once a month. That's what I do for all my clients, but at least every couple months, and check the status of your trademark application to make sure that nothing came down to the trademark office that you need to reply to and you just didn't get it. Maybe you didn't get the email, for example, or you just forgot to do it. So checking the status of your trademark application will prevent that from happening most likely. So those are the five top mistakes. So I'm going to go over them again. Number one, not doing a search. So make sure you do your search. Number two is making sure you don't use the word, the phrase that you're trying to trademark as in a merely descriptive kind of generic way on your own website or in your own marketing. Number three is in intent to use applications. You want to be careful about filing those applications before you've decided your branding so you don't change things later and have wasted your time and money. Number four is picking the wrong class. You have to be artful in which class you're in and the actual description of the class that you pick. Number five is making sure you don't miss a deadline. So thank you guys so much for watching this. If you found it helpful, please go ahead and hit the like button. Of course, subscribe if you like more tips about trademarking or just small business law generally for small businesses and online entrepreneurs. And feel free to leave a comment below if you have any questions about anything that I've talked about or related to trademark law that you where you'd like an answer, and hopefully I can point you in the right direction. Thanks a lot for you guys for watching. See you later. Bye-bye.